degrees Celsius, 73 degrees Fahrenheit, here on the rolling granite plains of Juma and Arethusa. There is a gentle breeze blowing to my back. There is a chinspot batis calling off to the west. Otherwise, all is peace, and those impala are gently feeding their way through this midwinter bush. My name is James, for those of you who do not know. Behind the camera, we have Jeandre. He has a fairly odd arrangement of headgear this afternoon, a very trendy cap and a slightly less trendy bandana. In the control room, we have Tara and the wildebeest, Viam. And on the other vehicle, we have B-squared, Brent and Bryan. Now, as I said earlier this morning, I was deeply jealous of Brent and Bryan and struggled to overcome the struggles of ego when all that we managed to find was a mongoose poo and indeed run over a big lion poo, which we thought was a kill nearby. This was distressing to me. I'm hoping that this afternoon will turn out better. Both Jeandre and I have been meditating powerfully throughout the course of the mid-morning and hoping that the universe will cease to spit upon us and give us some great entertaining sightings. Please remember, we love to hear from you. Any questions, any comments you have, if you're on Twitter, hashtag Safari Live, if you are on the email, questions@wildearth.tv. Tara at the moment does not take phone calls, but we're working on that, and so one day you might just be able to phone her. That's it. Our plan this afternoon is to head down to the little waterhole down here and then onto the southern boundary and see if there hasn't been any crossing from some spectacular animal. I'm truly hoping for wild dogs because they have denned apparently on a reserve called Mala Mala, which is one farm away from us here, and they will definitely come and use Juma to hunt on. So we may be lucky, we may not. We may just find mongoose poo, but we hope not to. Right, welcome to the drive. Enjoy it, and it's great to have you along. Yes, throaty roar from the 2.8 litre V6. A nice question from X Ranga. Thank you, X Ranga. You want to know, what does lion dung smell like? There is nothing else in the world, X-Ranga, that lion dung smells like. Lion dung is the worst smelling thing in possibly the entire universe. The paint is sort of melting around the wheel hub where we ran over the lion dung, and that is because the immense power of the smell. The last remaining hairs that I used to have on my head were in fact singed off when I was standing next to the wheel. The smell of lion dung is utterly appalling. It is far worse than any doggy do you could imagine. Something through there. No, oh well. No, just a termite mound with a horn on its nose. Some beefaloes. Hello, Kathleen in Glenfield, is it, New York? Lovely question, thank you. And while we look at these beefaloes, I shall answer it for you. You saw on the Juma cam today some zebra eating what looked to be soil. This is not uncommon. You're not going insane. The zebra probably were doing exactly that, and they'll do it more and more as the winter progresses. It's something called geophagia. Phagia meaning eating, and geo meaning earth, as far as I'm aware. Soil eating. Or earth eating. And what it does is, the reason for it is that as the nutritional content of the vegetation goes down during the winter time, so the animals must seek out other sources of minerals, and those areas around the water holes are often fairly full of minerals, and so they'll be it's sort of like a salt lick almost. The soil is rich in salts, and that's what the zebra would be doing. And lots of other animals that will do the same. And what I've done it once before, and I'll find another area that is what we call a sodic area. So an area that has an unusually high salt content in the soil, and I'll taste it for you and tell you what it tastes like. In previous experience will tell me that there is a very slight salty taste, but it's not something I would sprinkle upon my spaghetti bolognese. So these buffalo, as they always seem to around here, have come down to have their midday constitutional. They lie in the shade and eat their cud. I think they do most of their grazing, having watched their rhythms over the last 3 weeks. They probably do most of their grazing at night and then in the early morning. Then at midday, or when it gets a bit hot, they come down and they drink. And they lie around and re-chew their breakfast and lunch, which is an appalling thing that they have to do, but I'm glad I don't. And then they wander off again as the evening comes, you know, as it cools down. That's their general rhythm. Now remember, these buffalo will have to drink at least twice a day in winter because the vegetation is so dry. And as long as they can do that, they'll remain healthy and in good condition. And you can see the best way to check whether they're healthy or not is to see whether their hips are showing. And I've got to tell you, compared with the cattle in the community lands outside of the reserve, these buffalo are in far, far better condition. And they're just gently grunting at each other. That's a very good point. Elise, you've made an excellent point that I just glossed over it because I see these so often. Jeandre, can you go to the sort of right-hand side of the herd, and at the very back there's a much smaller one. Elise, this is not a breeding herd as far as I can tell, and if it is, it's a very small one. That said, there does look like there's a cow at the back. So there's the youngster that Jeandre is focusing in on now, and the one whose nose you can just see poking up at the sort of left-hand side of your picture, that looks like a cow to me, and I can tell that from the fact that her horns don't have that sort of obvious helmet like the males do, and that is quite interesting. So what will be going on there is that she will be seeking the protection, obviously, of the other buffalo, and the youngster may or may not be related to her. I'm quite interested to see whether he's a bull or not. I think he looks... No, I don't know. I can't tell from here. I'd have to see between his legs or her legs. I'm not sure where they would have come from. I know there was a herd just north of here. So would we call this a breeding herd? Probably not. We'd probably call it a bachelor herd with a couple of hangers-on. Very well spotted, Elise. There's a really nice, there is quite a nice cow there, leaning on the back of one of the other buffalo. Hello, Lynn. Lynn, it is very unusual to see one mother and a youngster with these. Oh, and there's a very small one there. Yeah, so, I mean, this is almost a breeding herd, I suppose. Lynn, it's very unusual to see this. I've not seen it before. I've seen a cow on her own only once before, and I suspect because she was ill. And normally, if you're on foot, you've got to be careful. If you find a cow on her own, it normally means that there are a whole lot of others around the place. But in this case, I really don't think that's happened. So, how these, maybe, those three, you can see the youngster, the sort of sub-adult, the very little one and the cow behind, that bull is now going to perform a feat of acrobatics. Quite remarkable for something of that shape, size and design. Anyway, Lynn, I suspect what's happened is that they couldn't keep up with the herd that they are part of, and so what's happened is that they've come across this waterhole, they've come across these other buffalo, and they're going to hang around here for a while. Whether this will be a stable arrangement or not remains to be seen. I somehow doubt it. Now that's a tiny calf. Now, I suspect the calf just couldn't keep up with the herd. It's not newborn though, its horns have already erupted. We'll just drive around the side and then make our way out, but I just want to get a closer look at that other sub-adult. Definitely looking at us with a great sense of suspicion. And all around it smells like a dairy. I don't know if you've ever been to a dairy, but that's what buffalo smell like, and they obviously make their daily toilet around here, and it smells just like a dairy. So if you're walking in the bush and you smell a dairy, watch out. The other thing is that cow, you look at her hips. I'm just going to get a look at her as she walks away. I've parked Jeandre at a dreadful angle here, so if the picture's a little bit wonky, it's my fault, not his. If you look at the cow's hips, they're quite exposed. So she's not in great condition, and I wonder if she isn't sick, and that's why she can't keep up with the herd. And she's limping, so definitely. So I suspect that's why she's found these bulls, and she's just going to try and hang around with them and seek the safety that they provide. And that other little one, the sub-adult to the left of picture, we'll just get a quick look at him. That one there, that is a young bull, it looks like. And the youngster, the little one, is definitely trying to suckle as they walk. They will do that quite a lot. That's why it's quite interesting. They don't suckle from the side. So if you watch a horse trying to suckle, or a zebra, they suckle from the side, or an elephant even. Buffalo calves tend to do it from behind. So they knock the udders with their heads, and then the female, so that they can do it while they're walking slowly along, because the herd will move huge distances sometimes. Hi again, Lynn. Would the males protect the calf? That's a nice question, because it's got more than one sort of answer. They wouldn't protect the calf because of the calf. But what they would do is that they would provide protection, because any predator that came across this area, they would chase off. So if for example, a lion came into shot as we speak, what would happen is that the bulls would then chase the lion off, and through doing that would protect the calf. but they wouldn't actually necessarily rally around the calf and protect it. So indirectly, yes. And certainly, I mean, even if the lion got hold of the calf, they'd come in and try and chase the lion off. And a little oxpecker there that Jeandre has spotted. Quite nice there with its beak open. I hope you saw that. The oxpeckers, or all birds, will exhibit something called gular flutter, which is where their sort of form of sweating. Birds don't sweat, so they flap the skin, the gular flap, in the throat. And what happens then is that it sort of loses water. They lose heat through exactly the same way that we would when we sweat, or when a dog pants. Same way that of heat loss. It's not that hot today, so. Not sure why that oxpecker's gular fluttering. Now this is quite nice. We can see if that buffalo is going to rub its head, because so often we go past trees and they have sort of red patches on the bottom of them from where, especially the acacias, from where the buffalo have rubbed their horns and taken the bark off. And people often ask why, what is that red color at the bottom of the trees? And that's often what it is. Where the beef have taken off the outer layer of bark and exposed the red bit. Let's just try and get a slightly different angle here. Ooh. A bit bumpy here from the clay. Get a nice picture in there of his head, I'm not sure. There you can, yeah, you just see the cow walking out of picture there with the baby suckling as she walks. She's obviously stopped now, as I said there. This is quite a nice buffalo sighting. It's not often that they let us get quite so close as this. Normally do exactly that, they get upset. He's chewing his cud and looking at Jeandre with ill-disguised contempt. Now me. And you can see him chewing away. Always a very circular motion. They're going to press on. Hello, Susan in Long Island, New York. You want to know if these buffalo are the same species as Asian buffalo. They look quite similar, but they're definitely not the same species. If you try and milk one of these things for mozzarella, it'll be the last thing you ever milk. I can tell you that for free. In fact, that's not necessarily true. You can actually raise them from babies and they'll be relatively tame. But not the same. Definitely a much sort of more wild species than the Asian water buffalo. But very similar looking. So they are quite closely related, but they're not the same species. Lovely question. Really nice to get this close. Hello, ex-Ranger. Nice question, and it's going to lead into a bit of a discussion if these buffalo play ball and stay here. You want to know, are buffalo farmed commercially for meat here?
There are one or two people who do farm them commercially. Not so much for meat though, mainly for sort of breeding stock, because especially outside of the Kruger Park, where they are tend to be disease-free, so without this bovine tuberculosis that causes a problem in this area. You see the lovely shot of an oxpecker there, taking off a lot of ticks. So these buffalo are not readily domesticatable. They, like most African ungulates and big game here, show a tendency to homicide, so which is very inconvenient if you're trying to domesticate them. So much like the domestic cow comes from something called an auroch, which occurred in the Middle East, if I'm not mistaken, and into Asia. And that's where the domestic cow came from. Now, you must remember that all African animals evolved with people in Africa. So from the minute we came down the trees, and began fashioning rudimentary weapons from stones and sticks, we've been harrying them around the plains of Africa. So for the last 2 million years, that's what we've been doing. And over that period, they have become very wary of human beings and us on foot. And that makes African animals inherently far more difficult to domesticate than animals that didn't evolve with us. So in the East, in the Middle East, or in the Fertile Crescent, where agriculture first began, they could domesticate cows, and eventually cows and the ancestors of horses began pulling things and became draft animals. And in Africa, that didn't happen. So that simple question that you've asked about whether or not they're commercially farmed leads to a discussion on why it is that African civilizations lacked so much of the technology that Europe had. And one of those reasons seems to be the lack of domesticatable animals. So in Europe, or in the Fertile Crescent, they had the ancestors of horses. We had zebras, which are the nastiest animal herbivores of all. And where they had aurochs that became cows, we have these rather vicious buffalo. So, lovely question there. Thank you. Hello, Nigel and Crystal, avid watchers of the Juma Cam at the Gowrie Dam. That's an astonishing array of rhyming words, with totally unintentional. You said last night you heard buffalo making distress calls, and that you postulate that perhaps this cow and the youngsters with her were being harassed, and they were separated from a small herd by perhaps lions, and that's how they've ended up here. I'd say that's a pretty good postulation, but for the fact we haven't seen any big herd tracks. So the buffalo that you heard in distress, I suspect quite strongly, are that other buffalo herd, that other bachelor herd that lives around the Gowrie Dam, and they were probably attacked by the Nkuhuma pride at some stage, perhaps, just before they went north into Biffle's Hook. Hello, Donna in Maine. You've noticed the horns, some of the horns here seem to be quite honeycombed. And you're wondering if that is one of the horn borer moths perhaps causing that. No, Donna, it's not. It's as far as I know, those horn borers only really get into the horns and successfully sort of eat the keratin when the antelope or the buffalo die, not before then. So what that is that's from fighting, A, and B, from rubbing up against the trees. And they do that quite a lot, which will change the color and take the keratin off. Hello, Rocky fella. Nice to hear from you again. I have forgiven you for giving me one out of ten for my Nyala dance the other day. So I shall answer your question. You want to know, do oxpeckers specialize? So would the ones sitting here eating buffalo ticks go on to giraffe and eat giraffe ticks? Rocky fella, I'm pretty sure they would, you know. I think they're specifically unspecific, if you like. And I think I've definitely seen oxpeckers in sort of mixed group of antelope going from one to the other. It's a very interesting question, though. I'm not sure that anyone studied it specifically, but I think that that's probably, I'm sure that they'd be very fairly unspecific, given that they, you know, they want the ticks, not so much the animals. Hello, Miss Jin in Dallas, Texas. You want to know, are buffaloes solitary or social? Well, Miss Jin, I feel you have only to look at the screen in front of you to answer your own question. It is a nice one, though, because it leads on to a discussion of herd size and that sort of thing. And so, Miss Jin, what tends to happen is that the bigger an animal is, now you can just see, I'll answer your question now. Can you see that oxpecker there having a dust bath? Just next to the youngster facing us, Jeandre. Just in the sort of shadow to the right there. Miss Jin, I'm coming back to you. Fear not. It's just a young oxpecker having a dust bath in the shade provided by that young buffalo, which is quite sweet. And it's a juvenile oxpecker. You can see it doesn't have the red beak just yet. Well, there it's interacting with a mother or father or cousin or aunt. So, Miss Jin, buffalo herds are enormous in areas, especially where there isn't broken up water like there is here. So in areas like Botswana, you'll get herds of up to 1,000 quite regularly, and even in areas in Kruger you'll get that many. Now the key thing here, Ms. Jin, is that the bigger you are, the more obvious you are. And therefore, the more advanced you are, the more obvious you are. And therefore, the more advantage there is to being in a herd that gives you vigilance. So once you get below impala size, and it's quite interesting to see, impala is sort of the size limit, the smaller and everything smaller than an impala, herbivore-wise, tends to be solitary or living in small groups and pairs. Everything larger than that tends to herd. And that means that's because once you get smaller than an impala, it's easier to hide than it is if you're bigger than that. And so if you are bigger, you get into a herd because you accept that you're going to be seen, and so you have a lot of kind of vigilance, or you get vigilance and protection from numbers. Hello, Ginny. Nice question. Look at that. Look at that old bull chasing the youngster away. You want to know, Ginny, will the What has hitherto been a fairly friendly arrangement will fairly quickly turn into question. You can't see it just there, but you want to know if the calf has budded his horns or her horns. Answer is yes, they've just come out, and if I'm not mistaken, that put this on the dash here and you can have a look-see. I think that's the best example there, where my finger is. You can see their normal passerine foot, three front, one back, and they're ideally suited for this sort of thing. So the claws are, sorry, let me get this out of the sun. There we go. Jeandre has moved his bulk into the way. And what that is, I mean, those claws are probably slightly longer than, say, those on a wax bill, but all birds can hang at this sort of angle when they're feeding or when they're perching or doing something like that. So I don't think they're particularly differently designed. Right, I think we're going to move slowly along. Hello, Virginia. Nice question. You want to know, are the females brown or do they get darker with age? The answer is that they're born brown and then they get darker and darker as they get older. And the female is pretty much the same color as the bulls. She's there. You can see her now. There she is, sort of middle of the group there. And so you can see there that the female is in fact black, and the calf behind her is brown, and the calf will go black as it gets older. And you can see the semi-youngster on the left-hand side of your picture is sort of brownish black. Right, we're going to move on from here. We're going to go across to Brent. I'm not sure what he's found. I know that he was heading towards that incredible sighting of a quarantine. I think it was quarantine that he had this morning. So you're going to go across to him and see if he hasn't managed to relocate. And we're going to carry on in our quest for other great, interesting and exciting wildlife of Juma and the surrounds. See you later.
Welcome everyone. Hi, my name is Brent. I've got Bryan on camera, and I know let you know what we're up to. We've continuing to follow up on the most amazing sighting we had this morning. We were really fortunate. We got a tip off from Taxon, one of the guides at Juma, who let me know that there was cheetah tracks near Biffle's Hook waterhole. So Bryan and I went there, literally saw the tracks, And as I looked up in the direction the tracks were going, cheetah! So that was really, really exciting. And then we noticed some odd behavior, and they were sort of growling at this thicket of round leaf teak. And the cheetah growl is not the most impressive of the cats. It's sort of a... And then all of a sudden, out of the round leaf teak burst Quarantine, who's a young male leopard we haven't seen in a while. So really exciting. He then chased off the cheetah. We stayed with the cheetah till they crossed out of our boundary. And then we came back, and following the squirrel alarm calls and Franklin alarm calls, we managed to find that young male leopard again. So an absolutely amazing sort of chain of events this morning. And I did mention when we first went on air that I had a feeling something really epic was going to happen. So really, really wonderful. It's the first time for both Bryan and myself seeing cheetah since we've been here at Juma and Arethusa. And it's actually Brian's first time to ever see a cheetah in the wild. So really exciting for all of us. It took me quite a long time to calm down after drive today. Still going. But to let you know what we've done now is we've moved back into that area to look for that young male leopard. And he's been a bit of a sneaky boy. I followed his tracks heading west. He lay down quite close. Then he just turned around and came back on his tracks. And I've just spotted some of his tracks on the road here now. And I'm just going to try to figure out where he's gone. But really, really exciting. Absolutely amazing. I still start getting excited when I speak about what we saw this morning. So where did you go, Mr. Q? These tracks are quite fresh and from during the day, because when some of the game drives came through, they drove in on this road and his tracks are on top of those. I'm just going to turn around here. I'm going to have a quick look down the other road here, see if he didn't duck through the bush through that way, and then we're going to head back. I think time to turn around. Are we behind us? Good. So if you are a new viewer, welcome on the back of my game drive vehicle for a sunset safari. If you're one of our regulars, always great to have you with us. We are tracking, hopefully going to be finding a young male leopard. And we will be keeping you updated about what we're doing as we're going. So also we are, apart from only being not only being live, so you're seeing everything as we see it, we're also interactive, so you can send us questions. And you can do that by email, and the email address is questions@wildearth.tv. Or you can use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. The other game drives are getting moving, so I'm just going to have a quick chat to them. Afternoon, one station is following up on that. Wanunengwe around Buffles Hook Dam, Zinkonzo. Heading north on Buffles Hook east, and then there was a small Shamri Abunyari at Treehouse Dam. I don't think anyone is at that position, but only about 10 or 12 animals. Copy, will do. So, the last track I have is over there, but what happens quite often is with leopards that actually move through this area, they'll go off the road onto a nice big elephant path like that. Just gonna see if the tracks cross. Is there any tracks that side, Bryan?
Nothing at the moment.
Nothing?
Nothing.
So what I do quite often when I'm tracking is I won't get out and start walking on tracks immediately. I will sort of try make sure I've covered an area extensively to make sure there are no tracks leaving it before I get off a vehicle and try to find the animal on foot. What it does, it does sometimes make it much faster to find, to track the animals, because I now know he's not within a certain area. And so even moving in the vehicle, I can cover quite a lot of ground quickly. And then if there aren't any tracks crossing, I can come back. And then I know that that animal is in quite a small area. In terms of actually animal and bird noises this evening so far, quite a cool afternoon. Not too hot. I think it's going to get nippy really quickly when the sun dips below the horizon. Yeah, so I'm quite confident he hasn't gone this far yet. I'm going to zoop around. And there is a large termite mound that when leopards, whether it be quarantine young male or Kunuma, who's also another young male, or Karula, which is their mother, or Mvula, which is the dominant male in this area, I've seen all of them on and around that termite mound in the past. You see us, the leopard-like stump. So as we drifted through there, it's just what we're looking for quite often is something that looks a bit different. The shapes change, and there you can see that stump there just caught my eye. And for a second I thought, oh, is that? No, it's a stump. But that's the type of thing we're looking for when we are scanning the bush. Even sometimes a much smaller little ear flick or the white tip of a leopard's tail. Any tiny little detail that might give us the exact location on that animal. Around this evening. Cecilia, welcome on the Sunset Safari. Cecilia would like to know whether any farmers, local farmers in the villages outside the reserve, collect animal dung to use as fertilizer. Cecilia, they don't. I know they do use cow dung because most of the local farmers will have cattle. So they do use cow dung, but they do not collect any wild animal dung. Bryan, you ready? I think he's within this little zone here somewhere. Okay, there's a track. Now to just figure where he went from here. Ranga. Welcome on the sunset safari. X-Ranger's asking what I'm looking for to gauge the tracks. I've still got the tracks here. So I know the leopard's been in this area, so these tracks I know are somewhere from between, I'm guessing, sort of 9, I'll probably call it 10:30 and 3 o'clock. What I'm hoping is, because it's been warm and he did have quite a full bedding, he hasn't moved too far. Now it's just trying to discern where he went. So they have, during the day, there are other things like antlions that quite often make little trails through the sand, and there are no antlion trails that cut through his tracks. I think he's so close. I'm convinced when I was walking around looking at tracks a little bit early, I'm convinced he was actually watching me. I just had that feeling that something was watching me, and I think quarantine might have been. So the last track looks like it goes in here. Gonna do is we're just gonna go down where I can get access to the edge of the drainage line and have a quick look down there to see if we can find him. News. So there's a drainage line to that. Drainage line down here. I'm wondering if he hasn't come down to rest in the shade. Watch out there. Fallen down red bush willow in front of us. If we have a look under the branch, there's a little scrub here. Okay, let's see, you can spot a little bit to the left.
Oh, there he is.
There we go. You guys see him there? Tiny little scrub here, keeping very still before his nocturnal activities. His main defense during the day is to keep still. So he's been resting there for the whole day and will be waiting for darkness before he heads out. And he does that because he's most afraid of predatory birds. So that would pose the biggest threat to a scrub here, although leopard, lion, everything, if they can, will eat them. I think one of the more strange sightings I've seen is a wild dog's killer scrub here. It is very, very still here. So I think let's make our way back to the road And I'm going to loop around to the other side of the stranded vine where it's more accessible. And we don't want to disturb the poor scrub here. Keeping dead still. Sunset Safari, Virginia. Nice to have you on the back of the vehicle. But Virginia would like to know whether if quarantine had managed to capture one of those cheetah, would he have, if he killed the cheetah, would he have eaten it? Or would it just be removing another predator from the system that is a potential competition for him? It's very difficult to say for sure, but I think he would have just left it. It does happen from time to time that if he was really, really hungry and in lots of stress, he might have eaten the cheetah. But I think normally he would have just left the carcass. Speaking of cheetah, I don't know if we've ever had a good chance to have a proper look at a cheetah track. So while we are in this area trying to find this leopard, I'm going to stop off at the spot where I first saw those cheetah tracks, and we can have a look and have a little discussion about that. Where are you hiding? Cross across to Commander Bond while I keep scouring this area, and hopefully we'll be back with a cat a little later, but have fun with James.
Hello everybody, welcome back to Wendy. As you can see, our luck has changed. We have found Cobus ellipsiprimnus, the water buck. Young bachelor herd. We seem to have found a couple of bachelors today. There is the one of them. There are a few others off to the right-hand side. And the reason, basically, we stopped is A, because they're more entertaining than mongoose poo, and B, because they're so beautifully framed in the colors here. So I'm just going to sneak a little bit forward, and I just love the color of that gray coat juxtaposed with the gold of the cambritum leaves. So I'm just going to sneak a bit forward here, see if we can't get a better view of the waterbuck. There we go, it's not bad. It's right into the sun, so I'm giving Jeandre a bit of a challenge. So as with so many other animals out here, look at the colors there. Look, the young bulls will congregate together when they get tossed out of a herd long before they are able to take a territory. And they kind of grow up in a bachelor group of celibate males. But like the Zulu regiments of old, celibate man-slaying gladiators, although this chap's not really much of a gladiator at current stage. He's same stages of life as Junior, that lion we've been looking at in the Nkuhuma Pride, young male. He's got that sort of ugly teenager vibe about him, where he's a bit lanky and hasn't quite filled out yet. Very uncomfortable time of life for male mammals. I certainly didn't enjoy it, although someone of my proportions has never been lanky. You could just smell a bit of the musk on them. A And if you get close enough, it's quite a pungent, strong smell. And it's not entirely clear why they have it. You know, for a long time they thought that lions would avoid killing them, but lions don't avoid killing waterbuck. They'll happily kill them. I know that that musk gland, if you hunt them for the pot, not that I've done so with these particular animals, it can taint the meat quite badly. But I mean, a lion will eat the most foul, rotting buffalo carrion, and so that won't make much difference to them at all. So I think it's probably got to do with territorial marking more than anything else. And they've disappeared, so we're going to move slowly forward. In a subfamily with the buffalo, called the bovids, and then these are in the sort of antelope family, and they are called Cobus ellipsiprimnus. That's their sort of Latin name. They don't have a botanical name, obviously. They're animals, and then the bushbuck is Tragelaphus scriptus, so a totally different genus. Physically, a bushbuck is much smaller than a waterbuck. Waterbuck are roughly the same size as kudu, and a kudu is is probably three times the size of a bushbuck. Thank you for that question. Let us press on. Leave these waterbuck to their very unwatery habitat. See what else we can see. So we had a question earlier about geophagia around the dams, and for those of you who are just tuning in, perhaps pouring your evening snifter before settling down to watch the game drive, it's a process called geophagia, where animals will eat soil in times of nutritional deficiency in the vegetation. Now I can smell the waterbuck now. They've obviously come through this area. Anyway, much better than the lion who we ran over earlier. And what they will do is they'll go down towards much lower lying areas. So if you look above, sort of down the road there, you can see it's quite sandy soil, not very clay rich. And because this land is so ancient, most of the soil on these ridge crest areas where the marulas like to grow have leached out just about all the nutrients. And so the nutrients tend to flow down over the centuries towards the drainage line areas, and then they collect in the bottomlands, and they form these sodic areas, and that's where you'll find animals eating the odd bit of soil. So we'll try some of that when we get lower down. Civet tracks around. I have yet to see a civet here. I'd really like to see one. I think they come out rather late here. So some fairly old lion tracks, which are not very obvious, so I'm not going to show you. You feel like doing a track there. There's a batalier there. He's quite nicely flying for us. No, he's going down. Sorry about that. Quite interesting that he's going down. They are scavengers. But I think there'd be a lot more activity if he was going down on something to eat. That was a batalier we were trying to find before we dropped out of the sky. Okay, so Lynn, you have seen a documentary where you've seen lions killing hyena, but didn't necessarily eat them. So that's quite interesting. Now, I don't know whether they would have just rejected them outright, or because they taste bad, or perhaps they moved on because they had other things to do, or maybe the documentary just didn't film it, I'm not sure. I'd be very interested to know if there are any records of it. So that's one record where they didn't eat the hyenas. Thanks for that, Lynn. I wonder if you've seen that film. I think it's, there are a couple of them. I think it's Eternal Enemies, which the Joubert's made about the hyenas and the lions. And the lions would definitely kill hyena if they can find them. There is no tolerance at all. The predators have no tolerance of each other at all. Ranga, thank you, all the way from Tasmania, home of the great Ricky Ponting. Thank you very much for your contribution to my coffee fund. You say you're prepared to go Harvey's for a couple of perhaps lilac-breasted roller feathers. For those of you who don't know, Rick and Susie in Hawaii offered me some newfangled kind of coffee that sounds delicious if I send them two lilac-breasted roller feathers. So I am scouring the bush for those feathers as we speak. I do enjoy my coffee, and I especially enjoy it at 0500 before I come on game drive. Gilly from Wisconsin, you ask a perplexing question. I'm going to stop here in the shade of this great marula tree just to explain. So you say it's confusing to know what you call different kinds of antelope. Do you call them does or fawns or lambs or ewes or rams or bulls or cows? Basically, the rule out here is as follows. If it is bigger than a bushbuck, it becomes, the males are all bulls and the females are cows. If it is smaller than a bushbuck, or bushbuck and smaller, the males are rams and the females are ewes. The babies then are lambs, and bigger than bushbuck, the babies are calves. Does and buck are not terms we use out here. There is a bit of a South Africanism where we refer to any sort of herbivore as a buck, or an antelope as a buck, but that's, I think, if I'm not mistaken, an American term. I think it's an American hunting term even for a stag, if I'm not mistaken. We can check that up. But and strictly speaking, we wouldn't use the term buck out here. And a doe is a deer, a stag is a deer. And I'm not sure, I think it's a fawn, it's a baby deer. And we don't get deers natively in Africa at all. Get them in India, then you obviously get them in the Americas, in the New World. But we don't have any deer species in South Africa that occur naturally. There are various feral populations of, I think they're called fallow deer, around South Africa. But they're not naturally occurring. I hope that clears that up for you, Gilly. Thank you for the question. It's a good one. Some old lion tracks on this road, but I think they must be from the Nguma pride that we saw the other day. Hello, John Boy. You ask if I haven't had that tremendously expensive coffee. That I think it's made, if I'm not mistaken, from the beans that have been passed through the gut of the Asian civet. harvested from the dung, ground out and drunk? The answer is no, I haven't had any of that. A, because I'm too poor, and B, because I find the notion of soaking civet dung in water and then drinking it to be repellent to my person. And Jane, you ask, follow on from that is a nice question. You say, aren't civets related to skunks? Civets are not in fact related to skunks very closely, but they do have an certainly out here. I mean, you do get Asian civets, and I'm not sure what the situation is there. But civet dung here, in a, what they call a civet tree, which is a midden of civet dung, smells almost as bad as the lion dung that we ran over today. And the thought of putting that in a cup with some boiling water makes me quite nauseous. I'd love to know if anybody's had that civet dung coffee and what it actually tastes like. Civets are in fact a part of the family Viviridae, and they're more close, they're quite closely related to mongoose. Questions from Jemps in Johannesburg. Jemps is a clearly a budding young naturalist. First of all, he'd like to know what my favorite animal is. Jemps, my favorite animal other than the human being at the moment is the wild dog, although I'm becoming quite partial to hyena, having spent some time with them over the last few days. And I don't think we spend nearly enough time with hyenas. They tend to be rather spectacular animals. I forget the second part of your question. I'm sure it will come through again. And then a question which might be interpreted as nitpicking slightly. Jim says that he's heard that a Nyala bull is a bull and the Nyala cow is a ewe because of their substantial size difference. I have heard both terms used, but I think it's a little silly to split it across the species like that, so I refer to it as a Nyala cow. Thank you for your questions, Jimps. It's nice to have you on board. I think your first game drive was yesterday, so please keep sending through your questions. So we're going to go back across to Brent. We're back on the southern boundary now, and we're going to head across further to the west, and we're going to see what Brent has found. Good luck.
Everyone, I've just found something quite interesting to show you. So what we're going to do is I'm going to hop out of the vehicle quickly. And I'm going to circle something. So there's a track for you guys to try identify. Very interesting track. So not only I'm going to ask you what animal this is, I'd like to know how old this track is. What animal and how old is this track? And there is another one over here. It's the same animal. And if I look carefully around, and another one here. So There's two of these animals. And I'd love to know how old the tracks are and what animal they are. So, an update. We've been trying to track a young male leopard whose name Quarantine. And he is, I think, sniggering in a bush somewhere. I think I've probably walked past him three times. And he just doesn't want to be found. But I haven't given up yet. We are going to widen our search a little bit. And go further to the east and then make our way back here. And hopefully we'll find something. Because I think after the party that was this morning, the bush seems to have a hangover this afternoon. There's not much out there. But don't worry. As I was saying earlier this morning, quoting good old Mick Jagger, you don't always get what you want, but if you try real hard, sometimes you'll get what you need. So even though we might not always get the lions and leopards and cheetahs that we want, the bush is such an amazing place. There's always what we need here.